Thank you everyone for being here tonight. I considered reading my name Moa's bio for this introduction, but she means so much more to me, to us at the Hmong American Writers Circle, that I want to share with you tonight how much she actually means to us. My name is a pioneer, a visionary. She saw a path that needed to be made, and not only did she take the first steps in creating the field of Hmong American literature, she always held a hand out and was ready to pull any and everyone along with her. Although she didn't know it, we too here in Fresno grabbed hold. It was in the Hmong Liberty Journal that she founded and edited, Pandao Voice, where I published my first poems, where many of us in the Hmong American Writers Circle published our first few poems. If I never got a chance to thank her before, I'll do so publicly tonight. Thank you, my name. Your passion, your cultivation has brought Hmong Liberty Arts to where it is today. I remember when the Hmong American Writers Circle founder, Burley Vang, returned from UC Davis with his English degree. He told me he felt lonely as a Hmong writer, wanted a group like the one in Minnesota that workshopped and published Pandao Voice. He stood outside our student union, literally out there, and he handed out homemade flyers trying to recruit people to that first workshop. I remember him holding up this anthology, the one my name edited, she put it together, Bamboo Among the Oaks, the first Hmong American literary anthology, and him saying to us, maybe if we work hard, we too can one day publish a book of our own. My name's work helped us form our own creative writing collective. It allowed us to dream, and nearly a decade after Bamboo Among the Oaks, came out, we published our own anthology. Woo! And of course, we solicited her and she has a piece in ours as well. My name was instrumental in influencing Burley, myself, and my Dur Vang, another of our Hawk colleagues, whose first poetry book, Afterland, this book, won the Academy of American Poets Walt Whitman Award last year, and who we learned just the other day is a recipient of a Lannan Fellowship. So we're extremely proud of her for that. And all of this really is possible. All of this really is possible because of your vision. The Hmong literary movement would not be what it is today without my name. She is a treasure. She is the mother of the Hmong literary movement. And I'm honored to have her here tonight to share with us her new book, The Bride Price. Please join me in giving her a hand to invite her to the stage.
Story came out in March of this year. I'm going to give you an overview of the book, and then I'm going to read from the different sections. A show of hands, how many of you have had a chance to read yet? Okay, so a few of you. Great, good. We're going to engage in some cool conversations. I'm going to read a little bit more because most of you have not read the book yet, so you'll get a flavor of what the book is about. Now the book is divided into three parts. The first part, and the three parts follow the shaman's journey from trauma to healing. So the first part is called Bumpli, or soul loss. So animist Hmong believe that each of us have multiple souls or spirits, and that when trauma happens, one or more of those souls run away from the body. That's when you get sick. And oftentimes, the spirits are left at the spot of trauma. The second part is called Hubli, or soul calling. Now, in order to get well, when you've lost one or more of your souls, you have to call a shaman, a spiritual healer, to come and do a soul calling ritual for you. Now, the job of the shaman is to go into the spirit world and to find your lost soul or souls. And oftentimes, they return to the spot of trauma, and they find a little bug or something. The third part is called Made Whole. Right now, there's not a Hmong equivalent, because I'm a Christian girl, and I didn't know, like, Bumpli, Hubli, and then what's the third part? Like, there's something else, right? But I couldn't think of it, but I made it up. So in the second printing of this book, I've asked my editors to edit that third part, so it's Jompli, Made Whole. So, and, you know, Hannah's mom, you can tell me if I'm so off base or something. But so when trauma happens, one or more of your souls run away from the body, you get sick. The shaman comes, and he or she goes to the spirit world, and they find the lost souls. They bring the souls back home to your body, and that's when you become better. So this book is for my two daughters, Erica Bakchenya and Samantha Shoya, who taught me to love unconditionally. May you grow up to be brave women. Now, this is a memoir, and that's important because, you know, one of my early readers just said, you know, he writes fiction, and he said, why would you write all this? I said, because I'm a writer, because that's the shit that happens, because it's real, because, you know. Other people, you know, who know the story have their own perspectives and their own versions of what was said and what happened. Now, this book is also not a scholarly or academic work among customs, rituals, or traditions. Because of my own level of knowledge, the literal interpretations of animist rituals and traditions that I provide are at that first stage of translation only. So it's at the stage of a little kid's talk, rather than the second level of polite, nuanced, flowery language or metaphors. I call it monk speak. And the advanced level of practitioners, such as shamans or minkum. So you have to understand that when you read this book, you know, I'm gonna talk about some Hmong rituals and traditions, but that they're at the very basic level of understanding, you know. And then the concept of family, you guys know, we have so many families around, right? So the concept of Hmong family extends beyond our nuclear family. And out of respect, I call people aunt, uncle, grandmother, or grandfather who are not our relatives by blood, but because they are of that same generation. So in this book, I collapsed a lot of the uncles into just uncles, you know, aunts, grandmother, grandfather. And they could be people from my mom's side or my dad's side. And part of that was just to protect them, that I didn't name people. That the people I named, I asked if they were okay being named, or if they wanted me to make up a name or, okay, all that aside. So this is where the book starts. And if you want to follow along, those who have your book, I'm on page 3. So. You were like animals that had left their pens, animals vulnerable to tiger attacks. But now you have recognized your masters, and you have returned home, said my uncle. Now imagine this in Hmong. Nenya otu chia. That was how the Nong Dong Chong ordeal started. This was the Hmong American version of the prodigal son whose parents threw him a party after he had returned home. Only I wasn't a son, and this wasn't a celebration. It was 2012, 9 years after the church wedding that my family did not attend. and 9 years after the Dongcheng, the traditional Hmong marriage ceremony that my husband Wong and I did not attend. Nia, mother, and my uncles have decided to finish the Na Dongcheng, the final part of the Dongcheng. This meal is the public piece of the Dongcheng that permits both families to acknowledge the marriage. When it is done, Nia will finally feel that we recognize her as our mother. Blanc will earn his titles of Vo or son-in-law, and Ye Yi or brother-in-law. I will get my dowry from my family, which will include the Hmong clothes that Nia has saved up since I was a little girl. With my Hmong clothes, I will finally feel Hmong and loved. The Na Dongcheng gives my male relatives the opportunity to introduce themselves to my husband. They do this by drinking rice wine, beer, or other alcoholic beverages, and a kind of hazing for the groom. The more male relatives I have, the more Blanc will drink. It is a show of strength that says, don't mess with our daughter, sister, niece, cousin, or you will answer to us. For most Hmong couples, the Na Dongcheng is an automatic part of the Dongcheng. It usually takes place immediately after the marriage and negotiations. Blanc and I, however, had to earn our Ma Dongcheng, or at least that was what it felt like. It took us 9 years. While other couples have married and divorced during the 9 years since Huang and I were legally married, we have only now earned our Hmong anniversary. Finally, in the eyes of the Hmong community, we are officially married. This first section on page 7 is called The Trouble With Me. And this is how the book starts. Nia, if I got married, would you want to collect a bride price? I asked my mother. Of course, what parent does not collect a bride price? She said, her face glued to the TV screen. It was 2003 and we were at the Margaret Street house on the east side of St. Paul, our first home. I bought the house when I started my first salaried job in 2000. I was so proud of my family, finally living one piece of the American dream. There have been parents who have not collected a bride price, I insisted. One culture expert told me that in Laos, leaders such as General Van Pao, Tu Bi Li Fong, and Dr. Ying Dao did not collect bride prices for their daughters. Even one of my maternal uncles, a major in General Van Pao's army, had done this. Here in the U.S., other Hmong parents who did not collect bride prices were often Christians whose daughters married other Christians. My family had converted from animism to Christianity when we came to the U.S. in 1981. My boyfriend's family had been Catholics since the early 1970s in Laos. Nia had met Blanc when he came over to her house for Thanksgiving dinner in 2002. She never asked if I was planning to marry him. Whom and when you were married were things you did not discuss until they happened. Hmong parents did not want to give the impression that they had consented to the couple's courtship in case they did not work out. You are a daughter, and so we must ask for a bride price, she stated calmly. Nia, I'm not a bag of grapes. Even a bag of grapes, you have to have money to get it, said Nia, with a gleam in her eyes. She often had this gleam in her eyes when she was trying to be sneaky or funny about something, but this was no laughing matter. I do not know if she was trying to lighten the mood, or if she was happy that her 28-year-old daughter was finally asking about marriage. I thought she would feel differently about the bride price, given her own history with it, but she was even more insistent. Not wanting to start an argument, I did not push her further. Do you think Nia will want a bride price when I get married? I asked my older brother Kai. As he had always done since we were kids, he was up early watching Saturday morning cartoons. I stood to the side of the TV, making sure I was not blocking his view. It was a lame question, since I knew the answer already, but I needed an opening. If I could not get through to Nia, maybe Kai could. Maybe if I had his support, the two of us could more easily persuade her to change her mind. Although I was younger, Kai consulted with me in making decisions that affected the family. Buying Nia's vans, buying the Market Street house, we were good partners when it came to dealing with Nia. Since her father died when we were young, we took turns in handling her. I think so, said Kai. Anyway, it's not up to you to decide. Why isn't it up to me? It's my wedding. That's not how it works, Mai. Usually it's the parents who decide whether or not to collect the bride price. What he meant was, I did didn't get a say in this. Well, I don't want one. I don't want to feel like I'm bought and paid for. It's not like that, Mai, said Kai, turning off the TV. He called me Mai with a long I, as if trying to placate me. You just don't understand what it is. That's why you say that. Later, I would learn from my elders that the bride price is known as Plei Meng, which translates as the price for milk and care. It is the debt owed to the parents for the milk and care used to raise a good daughter. It thanks them and says, we are marrying your daughter. It compensates the bride's family for their future economic loss because the bride will leave her family. Anything she makes from this point on will belong to her husband and his family. The elders say the bride price is a promise that the groom and his family will love and care for the bride and it will not abandon or abuse her. Since they've invested good money in the bride, she is valuable and they will take good care of her. If the groom's family pays the requested bride price, it means they want the bride in their family. Although I didn't fully understand it, I said, I understand what it is. I just don't want it. Stop talking like that, Mai. It's not up to you. Nia will decide that. Can you talk to Nia and ask her not to collect a bride price? Kai looked at me as if to say, did you not hear anything I said? After all she's done for us, don't you think she deserves something, he asked. He meant after my father died in Laos in 1975, Nia took care of my two brothers and me on her own. Kai was 5 or 6 years old, I was 2 or 3, and my younger brother, Ye, could barely sit by himself. Nia was in her mid-20s. She could have remarried and left us to our paternal grandparents, as other young widows have done, but she did not. He meant, in 1976, a year after the Sika War ended, we fled our mountain villages and hid in the jungles of Laos. On her back, Nia carried a bag of rice, a blanket, a parachute, and my little brother. With one hand, she held my hand. With the other, she carried live chickens so we would have food to eat. Kai carried a small pot of cooked rice and walked alongside her. In the jungle, men who had guns hunted monkeys, squirrels, and birds. Nia caught fish in the streams and looked for crabs among the rocks. She scrounged for palm hearts, potatoes, and other edibles. Nia worked hard so her three children under the age of 8 would not die of starvation or malnutrition, as so many others did. After 2 years, we successfully made it across the Mekong River to the other side. The Mekong was the barrier between death or re-education camps in Laos and safety in refugee camps in Thailand. He meant during the 2 years in Ban Yu Nai refugee camp, Nia protected us from physical harm and disease, which killed a lot of people. He meant when we finally made it to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania in 1981, Nia, who did not read, write, or speak English, navigated the social service system so that we had a roof over our heads, clothes on our backs, and food in our stomachs. He meant Nia brought us to St. Paul, Minnesota in 1987 to live with our uncles. She worked hard to make sure we stayed out of trouble. He meant although Nia was poorly educated, she made sure we went to school on time, did her homework, and graduated from high school or college. Yes. After all that it had done for me, she deserved the money and respect of other Hmong parents, parents who believed that by getting a bride price, they were good parents of good daughters, worthy of someone wanting them. Of course, Nia deserves something, I said. Look, you guys can do all the Hmong culture and rituals you want, as long as you don't ask for a bride price. Did Blanc put you up to this? No, and not occurred to me that Kai would think Blanc has suggested it. Every Hmong man has to pay a bride price. Why should he? No, Blanc did not put me up to this. It's me. I don't want the bride price. I could see that I was getting nowhere with Kai. I was getting angry, and he was starting to speak faster. You're still Hmong, aren't you? Asked Kai. Of course I am. Then this is how Hmong people get married. I'm not saying I'm against Hmong marriages. I just don't want a price on my head. That's part of Hmong marriages. I know, but look, don't you want to make me unhappy? Of course I do, but what about what I want? You have to choose if it's more important to make yourself happy or to make me unhappy. Okay, so the second reading is about the wedding. years after the church wedding, I still had not printed one picture of my wedding day. No pictures of the walk down the aisle, traditional monk clothes, no bride in her ivory off-the-shoulder dress from Macy's, no bridesmaids holding their bouquets of silk flowers made by the maid of honor, no groom surrounded by his groomsmen who were, I was sure, thinking, this is your last moment of freedom, you sure you want to do this? No bride and groom cutting the cake quilt, 16 6x9 cakes baked by 16 willing volunteers. No just married couple facing the sea of mostly Caucasian faces. It was not that we did not take any photos. Our photographer took hundreds of photos of us setting up the sanctuary and dining hall, the rehearsal at the church followed by the barbecue at Long's house in North Minneapolis, the wedding party at Loring Park, and the ceremony. There were pictures of family and friends from near and far. There were even pictures of the monk dinner of egg rolls, beef lap, rice, and salad topped with a purple orchid. These captured images sat undeveloped on a CD locked away somewhere in the house. Why had I not developed the photos? Was it because I was too busy? Was it because they would be too expensive? Was it because I was ashamed of what I had done and was hiding the evidence? When the unkind did not show up to the church wedding, when I heard that my uncles banned everyone in the family from coming, when I could count the family members at the wedding on two hands, I questioned my decision. I had second thoughts when my family did not call me for a year, when Belong and I were not invited to family functions, when extended family members purposely asked if Belong was my boyfriend, when my family did not call Belong by his proper titles of Volworthy Yi, when I was most sad and wondered if I had done the right thing. Sometimes my extended family members looked at me as if they wanted to kill me, as if they could not stand the sight of me. I understood they were being supportive of Nia. They were angry for her. They were feeling her pain and made sure I knew. None of them ever said a word to me. But their eyes told me that what I did was worse than living in sin with a boyfriend, marrying a non-Hmong man, having a child out of wedlock. It was even worse than marrying a black man. I know I'm indicting a whole culture here, but most Hmong parents have a hierarchy of preferences when it comes to whom you should marry. Hmong first, then Caucasians or other Asians, and lastly, Black Americans. It did not seem to matter that I got married when I was 29, not 14. It did not matter that I married an attorney, a member of one of the professions toward which Hmong parents push their kids. I was ready for a fight. Like Nia, I was quick with my tongue. It did not matter if my words came out in Hmong English or some combination of the two. My opponents would feel the venom. I knew enough dirt on all their kids that I was a pit bull ready to bite at the drop of a word. I stared back at the family members, daring them to say something to me. They never said anything to my face. But behind my back, they gossiped about what a bad daughter I was, how I thought I was so smart and didn't need to listen to anyone. What a bad example I was setting for younger cousins. There were days when I fantasized about the huge weddings of other Hmong couples I had heard about or been to. These weddings were held at fancy hotels where both families were happy for the couple. The ones where leaders such as General Meng Pao or Dr. Ying Dao, the first Hmong to earn a PhD, showed up. The ones who had a wedding party of 30, 12 bridesmaids, 12 groomsmen, 2 ring bearers, 4 flower girls, the ones that had 500 guests. Although the couple did not know all the guests, as Nia stated, they came because of the parents. Hmong people loved to show off that they could afford to feed 500 people, all witnesses to their lavish weddings. These weddings were a way of giving face to the parents. Yes, it was superficial, but I wanted others to brag and gossip about my big wedding too. It was not that I wanted the headaches of a wedding party of 30 or the expenses of feeding 500 guests I did not know or care about, nor did I need Hmong leaders to validate my wedding. What I wanted was to give face to Nia. Nia, who of all parents deserved the most thanks, the most praise, the most respect. This was my one opportunity to show Nia off. She too should have her daughter's wedding at a fancy hotel. She too had earned the respect of Hmong leaders and 500 witnesses. I wanted all those people to say, my Ning's mother is a widow, but she was able to pull off a wedding as big as other parents. I wanted a wedding that I could have been proud of. After 4 years of being married, as I looked at the hundreds of photographs of my one-month-old baby for the first time, I understood why I never developed the wedding pictures. Like the wedding videos that I could not watch, or rather watched, but did not see because, as Wong stated, you bawled through the whole thing. The photos were a reminder that Nia, Kaya, all my Hmong relatives did not come to my church wedding. Absent from the happy faces was the most important person, Nia. If I did not have the photos, I would not have to be reminded she was not there. If I did not have the photos, I would not have to deal with people's questions of, oh, where's your mother? Nia's absence was a slap in the face. Years after the church wedding, I can see the imprints of her white hand on my red face. It stings still. I know, I'm so serious. After a party at Uncle's house, we were told to go talk to Uncle at law in the garage. It was typical for Hmong fathers to ask their brothers to talk to and discipline their kids if they thought their kids would not listen to them. Uncle and Law were already sitting down at the table in the middle of the garage. Two black metal chairs, the cold ones without cushions, waited for Long and me. The room was filled with a dampness that got to your bones and made you cold from the inside out. While everyone else was inside the house, watching TV and laughing, Long and I sat on the cold metal chairs in the garage and waited for whatever may come from our two interrogators. We were captives in the dungeon, and there seemed to be no way out. I wondered who was going to strike first. Your Law says he would like you to listen to Law's words, he said, clearing his throat. Law's slow speech reminded me of a turtle running. I was confused as to why he was talking about himself in the third person. He talked as if he was Law's messenger. I had never met anyone who talked about himself or herself in the third person. Maybe this is not the same Law who came to St. Paul to, quote unquote, untie the knot Long and I had caused by not wanting to do the Dong Chong. When he was in Minnesota for the Dong Chong, he had gotten sick and ended up at St. John's Hospital. When Long and I visited him at the hospital, he had said, live your life so as not to splash dirty water on the legs of the people nearby. As a writer, I could respect a good metaphor when I heard one. It turned out that I was not confused. He was Law. Law and Uncle wanted to know what we, no, not we, Long, thought about doing a hoop plea for me. I did not understand why they would even ask Long for permission. Didn't Hmong parents just tell their kids to come home so they could take care of their Hmong business? Then I remembered that my father-in-law had talked to Blanc a couple days ago, and Blanc had threatened to leave if they did one. We don't need to do anything. We're married now. It's done, said Blanc. It's not like that, Blanc, explained Uncle quickly, his voice rising. Uncle sported a spiked crew cut that reminded me of a drill sergeant. People would say we didn't do our part in welcoming Nya to the family, continued Uncle. If we don't do a hoopli for Nya, we won't be able to do a hoopli for your brother's wives when they marry. If we did, it wouldn't be fair to Nya, explained Long. We don't care what you do with them. They have nothing to do with this, said Long. No, Long, that's not how it is, said Uncle, who was thinking about ramifications for the clan. Listen to your Law, said Long. Around and around the talks went as I sat quietly and listened to the men. Was this taking so long because Law spoke slowly as if every word mattered? Or was it slow because they were repeating themselves like a CD stuck in one song? At one point, Law suddenly stood up. Uncle Law and I looked in his direction. Was he leaving as he had threatened? We all wondered. We held our breaths. Law walked to the long white plastic table at the edge of the garage, which had held aluminum trays of food a couple hours before. He grabbed a styrofoam cup his chair and sat down. We all thought Blom was leaving, but he had only gone to water. I almost laughed out loud to break the tension. All I could think about was, you're just talking about Dua Hoopley for me now? Blom and I had been legally married for 2 years. We had been culturally married for 1 year. In that time, we had been to Merced a couple times. Why hadn't this come up before? I was not angry that we were talking about it. I was mad that it took 2 years. A small part of me wondered if I should have been angry. Blanc's family might have felt they needed to do one, so my soul belongs to their family. But I'm Christian. Hoopley was not something my church or family did. It wasn't something I wanted, was it? So what did I care? Why did it matter that my in-laws had not done a Hoopley for me? Was I mad that they didn't do a Hoopley when they should have done one? Or was it because I didn't know there was something else to be done? Yes, no, maybe, I don't know. It was all of those things all at once. Then I knew why I was at the table. See, Uncle Flaw and the other uncles had had some version of this conversation before. Being typical Hmong men who love to sit and talk for hours about an issue that could have been resolved in 30 minutes, they had had multiple meetings on this issue. I did not know when, how many times, or if any of them had talked to Blanc before. This time, Uncle Flaw invited me to be a part of the conversation, not because they cared about what I thought or wanted. I was there to be a witness to the fact that they had wanted to do a plea. The only reason they did not do one was because Blanc and I did not allow them to do it. It was not their fault. If Blanc and I divorced later on, I could not blame them for contributing to the divorce by not doing their part in welcoming me to the family. Nya, you're a nya now. We've heard from Blanc. He doesn't want to do it. What do you say? If you tell us to do it, we will, said Blanc. I could only imagine how, quote unquote, famous that would have made me. Oh, how the Hmong and Merced would have talked about me. Like wildfire, those talks would have spread to Fresno, the other cities in California, and then to Minnesota. Oh, how my ears would have burned from all the gossip. Did you hear about that Hmong girl who was going to call the police on her family if they did a don't chunk for her? What? That's crazy. Why would she do that? She's mad because her family didn't give her a kidney. As punishment, she won't allow her mother to collect a bride price. That makes no sense. Well, they got married the American way, and no one in her family went to, not even her mom. 9 months later, there was a Zhong Chong, but they didn't go to it. 2 years after the American wedding, her in-laws haven't done a hoopli for her. Well, they didn't want her. Right, but she's demanding that they do a hoopli for her now. Doesn't she get it? They don't want you, girl. That's why they haven't done a hoopli for you. Nyan, what do you say? Law asked again. Law's question snapped me out of my thoughts. I gripped the cold metal chair to get a hold of myself. The room was cold, but I was sweating with anger. Law, I am only your nya, an outsider, I said in the calmest voice I could muster. In my head, I wanted to scream, I don't know why you haven't taken care of this yet. Now you want me, an outsider, a woman, to tell you, see, and uncle to do something for me? Instead, I said, this is a conversation you have to have with your son. If he says he wants to do it, fine, go ahead and do it. If he says he doesn't want to do it, I have no right to tell you to hoopli for me. It is not my place. I knew I had punted to Blom, making him the bad guy, but I was not going to let them put me in a corner and pin this on me. I was not going to give them the pleasure of saying, we didn't do the hoopli because Nya said no. This conversation was only happening because other Hmong people had been talking about how Blanc's family had not done a hoopli for me. Extended family members had not had the opportunity to formally meet me, their new nya. Did Si, Uncle, and Flaw really care about doing a hoopli for me? Maybe, but if they had really wanted to do one, like the Dong Chung that Blanc and I did not attend, they would have found a way. What they really cared about was their reputation. They were still Hmong after all, and this was what Hmong people did. I now understood this was a covered grass situation. I heard Nia's voice. You think you're so smart, but you can only read and write. You think you know it all, so you don't need us elders. We show respect for people. We elders may not be educated, but we know traditions and rituals. We remember who's done what to whom. We hold each other accountable for past wrongs. We know when people are fucking us over. Okay. Short session. Okay. I promise it's the end. In June 2012, my family decided to do the mortal chunk for us. If we do it, will you come? Asked Nia over the phone. Yes, we'll come, I told her. Blong and I thought the mortal chunk was happening because we had taken our kids to our family members to watch, showing them that we needed them. That perhaps they'd realize Blong wasn't as bad as people made him out to be. That since both sides had reconciled, or since Blong and I had earned it, it was time to do the mortal chunk. However, when I talked to Nia about it, she told me a different story. I didn't want the Yang people to accuse me of keeping the money for myself, said Nia. She was afraid that if she didn't do the mortal chunk, the Yang clan would accuse her of being greedy. She called my uncles, and they set a date. Just keep your mouth shut. Don't say anything, no matter what they say. Just bend and grin and bear it. Let them do their thing and be done with it, I told them. We were in the car of I-94 eastbound to my brother Kai's Blue Rambler in St. Paul. I knew Blong wouldn't like what I said, but he nodded. The less you say, the better, I continued. Blong again nodded. I knew he was doing this for me. Typically, the bridegroom and their entourage arrived together. We showed up at 8 a.m. as instructed by Blong's uncle. Apparently, they had shown up earlier. When we got to the house, the food preparation was almost done. I saw a handful of aunties and uncles outside and smiled at them. Since the First Hmong Baptist Church had their annual picnic on this day, I didn't see many of them, but that was okay. I wanted to get things done quickly. Blong and I made our way down to the basement, where they'd set up chairs around two long tables. There were men already seated at the table, including my first cousin on my mom's side, representing my uncle. Blong took his seat at the table. I stood back from the table with my four non-Hmong friends and the women, including Nia. I tried to interpret for my non-Hmong friends as best I could, but I too didn't know what was going on. I remember bits and pieces of what was said. My uncle opened the mortal chunk with, "You were like animals that had left their pens, animals that were vulnerable to tiger attacks, but now you have recognized your master and you have returned home." Later on, this uncle continued, "Your other wedding did not count. This is the one that matters." At some point, my cousin counseled Blong to be humble and for me to seek other good Yang wives from whom I could learn. When it came time for speeches, Nia did not want to say anything. She too wanted this to be over quickly. Then my male relatives, who had always been nice to us, came over with glasses of beer to recognize Blong as their Yi or brother-in-law. The older uncles wouldn't let them overdo it, so Blong only got two or three glasses. Then we must have had lunch, but I didn't really remember the food. As we left, Kai handed over the handwritten list of all the gifts that had been given by my family and friends as part of my dowry. Nia gave the big green suitcase full of my Hmong clothes. 9 years after our legal marriage, we were finally married in the eyes of the Hmong community. And I'll end with this. As a writer, it's always, beginnings and endings are always hard. The Mortal Chung is done. Blong and I have two anniversaries. The legal one in August 2003, and the Hmong one in June 2012. My uncle says, the one that counts is the Hmong one. The anniversary we celebrate is the one at the church where we wore our Hmong clothes. I am a writer, spinning tales of what it means to be Hmong in America. We Hmong are at the center of my stories. We are complex characters. We are the heroines, heroes, and perpetrators who don't need to be translated so that others may understand us. I told myself when I moved out against Nia's wishes, if you're going to do this, you better make it work. You better not come back home. There are many ways to be Hmong. My way is one way. Thank you.